I see trees of green, red roses too. I watch them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Well, I see skies of blue and clouds of white, bright blessed day and the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying that I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than we will ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
We are so pleased here at Unity Spiritual Center, pleased as punch, to welcome back our speaker today, Allen Klein. He is past president of the board of directors at that other San Francisco Unity. He has also spoken at Unity Centers throughout the United States, as well as being a retreat presenter at Unity Village. He is an award-winning professional speaker, a TEDx presenter, and the best-selling author of 30-plus books, including The Healing Power of Humor, You Can't Ruin My Day, Embracing Life After Loss, and the subject of today's talk, The Awe Factor. Please welcome Allen to our podium, and I look forward to hearing what you have to say, Allen.
So I am so grateful for a handheld mic so I can move around the stage, and I'm also really grateful for being invited back to speak here again, because I distinctly remember the last time I was here, there was some funny incident that happened. And what happened was, during the collection time, the two volunteers passed the basket around, and then for some reason they never came up to the stage to get it blessed. They just went zooming out the back door, and God knows where they went. But little did they realize, and I realized when they did that, it was April Fool's Day. And so we all got a really good laugh out of that. I don't remember what I spoke about that day, but today I want to talk about the awesome power of awe. And it's based on my current book, The Awe Factor. And there's a lot of wonderful, awe-inspiring stories in it, and I want to begin by sharing three of them with you. So one day I was in Yosemite, and I'm walking up to Vernal Falls, and there is a pathway up, and right next to it, there is a pathway coming down. And I'm walking up, I'm near the top, and all of a sudden, somebody coming down, young man, yells, "Alan, Alan!" And I look over, and I didn't recognize him. And then he said, "Don't you remember me? I'm John. I was an apprentice in summer stock when you were the leading scenic designer 40 years ago. Wow, somebody just said, wow, that is an awe experience. Now, some people might say, oh, that's synchronicity. I believe it's more than that. Second story, my mom was 82 when she took her first plane ride. And I met her here in San Francisco. She came from the East Coast. And I met her at the airport, and I said, "Ma, how did you like the flight?" And she looked at me and she said, "It was wonderful. I could see the tops of the clouds." And I thought, that was an awe experience for her. How often do you see the tops of the clouds? And it's only people who have flown and able to do that. And the third awe story I want to share with you is about a story I heard on the radio. And three prisoners were getting out of prison, and there was a reporter there, and he asked each one, what are you looking forward to when you get out of prison? And one said, "Naturally, I'm looking forward to being with my family. I haven't hugged them, I haven't seen them for many years." And the other one said, "I love baseball, and I can't wait to go see a live baseball game." And the third prisoner, and this is what kind of awed me, what he said, "I'm looking forward to opening the refrigerator." And I thought, that's an odd kind of thing. But then I thought, for 10, 15 years that he was in prison, he never got to get a glass of cold milk or an apple or anything from the refrigerator. He didn't even have a choice in what food he was going to eat. So for him, just opening the refrigerator was an awe experience. And so now when I go to my refrigerator, I just see it a little bit differently. So the fact, if you look at those three stories, awe comes in the mind of the beholder. That's one of the things about awe. The other thing, it's very different for different people. It's all, you know, it's in all around us, but not everyone sees it. Like the refrigerator is in awe experience. And the third thing, it's very hard to define. When I was ready to write the book, I had a coffee meeting with my former literary agent, Michael Larson. And he kept asking me, what is awe? And I thought, I gave him some answers, but then when I got home and I thought, that's not really, you know, I didn't feel comfortable with those answers. So I started doing research about what is awe. First place is the dictionary. And the dictionary says that it is reverence combined with fear and wonder. And I thought, fear? I don't usually associate fear and awe together. But then I thought about my childhood when there was lightning and thunder. And maybe some of you too, I would hide under the blanket, because the big light would come on in my bedroom, and then you know, this loud noise, it scared me. Yes, there was fear. The other thing, I also looked at what do researchers say. And researchers say that awe is like when you go to the Grand Canyon. There is something so vast, so big, that you cannot even comprehend it. And it makes you smaller, and you kind of start to understand a little bit of your place in the universe. But I thought, I like simpler kind of explanations. And so for me, awe is like when I get goosebumps, or when it knocks my socks off, or when I go, oh my God. You know, I went to two concerts this week, and each of the performers was so amazing that was kind of an awe moment when they'd hit a high note, or that it's such incredible interpretation of a song. So I came up with an acronym for AWE so I could remember it more simply, in a simple way, AWE, a wow experience. Whenever you go, wow, that's probably an AWE moment for you. So because I don't have a clicker, I have some wonderful slides for you, but because I don't have a clicker, and it's already up there. I actually was going to raise my hand for Cardi to advance the slide, but he already did it. So I won't always raise my hand, but I might. So what is AWE? We did that. I already did that. So you're very good, Cardi, because we can advance. I'll raise my hand. Next slide. Why is AWE important? So there's a number of researches that I've looked at. AWE has only been looked at by scientists in the last couple of years. For some reason, it wasn't important, but they're finding amazing things happen when you find something that awes you, that knocks your socks off, that you go, wow. One of them, and it's hard for me to believe this, but it could reduce inflammation. Amazing. The other thing is stress. These are all documented. And if I actually read it, it's pretty boring, but this is just a summary. The other thing, and I think this is really, really important for unity, because they about AWE is that you don't have to go to the Grand Canyon and Niagara Falls or Yosemite. You could just look at a picture. No, Cardi, not yet. Go back. I'm going to make my hand upside down. All right. you could just look at a picture and you will feel some AWE and you'll get some of those benefits. So I thought this is really good for unity, because one of the studies shows that when you find something in AWE, you are more generous. So I thought whenever you're asking for tithing, if you had a photo around of some AWE photo, maybe, just maybe, people will give more money. I don't know, scientific research, but you'd have to do your own. So one of the research that came out last year, and this really amazed me because it was so simple and yet it was so powerful. So what the research was, they took 52 people and divided them into two groups of 26 people each. And these were older people, 60, 70, 80, kind of like us, but you know, young older people. And so they had two groups, and they told one group, you're gonna go out in nature and you're going to look for things that awe you, that amaze you, that knock your socks off. And then you're gonna just note how you feel. The other group, they also sent them out in nature, but they said, just go out. Don't look for AWE, just, that's all they told them, go out in nature, see how you feel. And they only had to do this. This is what amazed me. They only had to do it once a week, for 15 minutes a week. That's AWE. And they did that for 8 weeks. Then they came back and they tallied and they asked, they interviewed these people, how did you feel? And the people that did not look for AWE, they said they, you know, it was an okay experience. In fact, some people said it was very stressful. One woman said all she did when she went walking in nature was think about the trip she was going to take in a couple of days, and she hadn't been packed yet. She didn't get everything she needed. And actually she was stressing out. And the other group that was asked to look for AWE said that they had less negative emotions, more positive emotions, and that they were happier and felt healthier. And it was only 15 minutes a week for 8 weeks. So I think it's really important, particularly to get out in nature, because nature is the number one generator of AWE. So no, Cardi, go back. Okay, so sunset or sunrise, Okay. Another one. And it's not Photoshopped. I looked at this one. And then this one. And this, when I first looked at this, my stomach dropped. And you can actually do this. It's somewhere in Europe. I think one of the Scandinavian countries. It's a way to walk on that rock. But this really hit me as, yes, there is fear in awe. Okay, so this is a black slide. I don't have pictures of every slide. Anybody see any picture here? Because if you do, you should probably talk to me at the end of the talk, because there's nothing. It is blank, and there'll be a couple more blank ones. So the other thing is not only in nature, the number one generator, but you can look around, there's also man-made awe. And I want to give you three examples of that. Anyone have seen any of the Cirque du Soleil shows? I've seen nearly all of them in Las Vegas, and when they come here, I am awed by them. I mean, the one about water, I sat in one of the first few rows, and one minute they're jumping in the water from 100 feet up, and the other they're walking on the water in about 2 minutes or less. You know, one with fire, one where the whole stage kind of tips over. I'm amazed by those. Man-made awe. The other, space travel. There are people now living in space, and they're growing a garden, and they recently made a movie all up there, somewhere out there. I mean, is that not amazing? Is that not awe-inspiring? And this amused me, because recently, maybe a month or so, maybe a little longer, Richard Branson sent up his own outer space ship. Guess what it was called? Anybody remember? Unity. It was called Unity. So that, because I'm a Unity person, that really, really, really worked for me. Okay, Cardi, I'm not gonna raise my hand. Yay. So how do you, if awe is important, and if it could do all these things researchers say, and it makes us happier and healthier, how do we get more of it in our life? How do we look for it? How do we find it? So in the book, I have several ways, but I just want to share three today. One is intention. Put your intention out to find the awe in your life. And you might say, well, how can I do that? Give you an example. A couple of years ago, I took a class, and it was called Wonder Hunt. And every day for 2 weeks, they gave us a little hint to what to go out and look for. Every day was different, and we were going to take a photo of it and then share it with the class. So one day it was to find everything that was heart-shaped. And so I went out, I walked my dog, and I came back. I hadn't found any on the walk, but when I came into my house, I had planted morning glories around my front gate, and every leaf was heart-shaped. And I realized, because I had that intention, I saw that. I had been walking my dog, you know, they were growing for 3 weeks. I hadn't seen them as heart-shaped. So set your intention. The other is be curious. The world is so amazing to be curious about it. Like a child, in Zen they call it beginner's mind. Just go out and see the world differently with a child's eye view, and you'll find awe. Give you an example of that. I was in a cafe. It was a little fence, and then I was able to keep my low fence, my dog in front of the fence. I was behind it at the table. And all of a sudden, this little child came by and saw the tail of my dog. It was a golden retriever with a big, fluffy tail. And the little child just went over and tried to play with it. It giggled when the wind of the tail went by. It tried to grab it, and the dog went, you know, away a bit, and he ran after it. And, you know, it wasn't a long time. Maybe the kid played with it for 5 minutes or 10 minutes, but the joy, the laughter on this child's face. And I thought, you know, I've lived with the dog many years. I never saw the tail as such joy and you know, such awe for this little child. And the other thing is to look at things, but look closer. So, Cardi, first slide. So this is, I was in Amsterdam several years ago, and outside of Amsterdam in the spring, there's something called Keukenhof Gardens. And they plant, this is a photo I took, they plant 7 million bulbs every year, most of them tulips. And so just walking in the front gate, I was like in awe, look, you know, they just surrounded you. And the thing is, I look closer and I found what I later learned was a Rembrandt tulip. So it has these striations. There was actually, years ago, there was some illness, disease, or aphid caused that. Now they grow them without the aphids. And I looked and I was amazed, but what really got me is when I looked closer and I looked inside. It's like a sunburst inside, and I never would have seen that had I not looked inside. So look and look closer. So, black slide, thank you. So I told you Michael Larson, my agent, wanted to know what is awe, and I did all this research for the awe factor book. And I finally came up with what I define as what awe is. Awe is the presence of the divine in the world. Everything has the divine in it. And particularly those awe moments. So what if I told you, yes, nature is the number one generator of awe. Yes, there's man-made things that are so amazing. In fact, I forgot to tell you one, so I'll put that in now. How many of you know the the Salesforce building in San Francisco? It is, and I'll get you the figures here. It is 1,070 feet tall. Imagine in your mind piling one of those buildings on top of it. So you get two Salesforce Tower buildings. That is not the tallest building in the world. The tallest building in the world is more than double that. In Dubai, it's 2,717 feet. How man could do this, you know, it just blows me away. Anyhow, back to awe is the presence of the divine in the world. And there's divine in that too, that man has this creativity that can do this. And that's a divine creativity. It's funny, when I'm on a plane, my creativity ramps up and I write a lot on a plane. And I always thought, I think I'm closer to the source. I don't know, I can't prove it, but that's my little theory. So what if the most divine thing was sitting right where you are? In your body, you are an incredible being. You are hearing, you're hearing what I'm saying. I'm hearing what the music and all, because I have hearing aids, man-made, but it also, you know, feeds into what I have left of my good hearing. You're breathing. One breath is keeping us all alive in this room. One breath. Is that not amazing? Is that not awe-inspiring? So I want to show you a film that kind of addresses this. So, Cardi, thank you.
And works in progress simultaneously. So to be human is to be extraordinary. I have a quote that just says, even on your worst day, you're a living mirror. If you think about the trillions of reactions that are happening just within the biochemistry of our physicality, it's overwhelming. That we can eat food with friends at a dinner table, and our body will take care of the process of digestion, when to secrete the bile from the bile duct, when to release more hydrochloric acid to break down the food. So the apple that you just ate at some point will become a liver cell. I mean, that is just mind-blowing, like magic, right? Yet we don't think about it. So when you really understand the endless myriad of transactions that are happening in the human brain and the human body that actually gives us the experience of being alive, it's humbling. You kind of can't help but feel a sense of gratitude and grace by virtue of the fact that I have a human. As a human, I have the capacity to see the people I love. The fact that I can smell, the sense that I can hear the dulcet tones of a loved one or a child telling me what they feel. And I can taste the extraordinary abundance of these different flavors that we get to experience by virtue of Mother Nature. Just those five senses that we take for granted every day. From when you really get it, it becomes impossible to not revere life, your own and others, to recognize what an immaculate conception every being is by virtue of the gift that it is that we get to experience life at all. Something that really hit home many years ago was that just to be alive is itself a miracle. And from that moment forth, I stopped berating myself. I'm not perfect. And there's so much humility and patience that we can develop when we understand that and then afford others. If we could afford each other just a little bit more patience, a little bit more compassion, a little bit more empathy for the fact that it is difficult. It is sometimes challenging to take on a new task, and that's okay. Then that again would make for a much more loving and accepting society. But within that, we never neglect the magic that it is to be a human being.
Next slide, Tony, the blank. Thank you. By the way, that film was done by a group called Fearless Soul Team, and the voice is Peter Krohn, and the video is done by a friend of mine, Ryan Harvey. So when I was growing up in New York City, I would go to see a Broadway musical every Saturday. I love Broadway musicals, I still do. And one of the shows I liked was Flower Drum Song. And I think the reason I liked it because they had a song in it, 100 million miracles. And they talk about, you know, the rain, the sun, the moon, 100 million miracles. So it's all around us. So I invite you to look for those. And as they said in the film, just to be alive is a miracle. So I want to end with quote by Albert Einstein about that, and he says, there are two ways to live your life. One is as though nothing is a miracle. The other is as though everything is a miracle. So let's take that thought into our time of meditation. I invite you to close your eyes. If that feels comfortable for you. And just take a couple of deep breaths. Breaths that help us center. Breaths that connects us to everyone else. Know that those breaths are part of keeping us healthy and whole and keeping us alive. And for that, we are so grateful. And invite you to maybe look around in your world and notice maybe one or two things that bring you awe, that bring you wonder, that you see as a miracle. It could be in nature, it could be man-made, it could be your family, It could be something within you. And just notice it. And now go a little closer to it. Look a little deeper. Hopefully you will see the beauty in it. You will see something maybe you hadn't noticed or been grateful about it before. And being closer, looking at it closer, perhaps it stirs your heart. Perhaps it brings you joy. Perhaps it is so beautiful. And just thank God for that being in your life. And now put that aside for a moment. And perhaps that was a flower that you were looking at, but if not, choose a flower that you've seen perhaps recently. And just notice its color. And just notice that maybe you don't even see this, but know that each bud, each petal of that flower is like no other in the world. There are no two the same, exactly the same, because of the color, the shape. And look at the stem, look at the green. Look how it's holding up that flower. Even though it might be a huge flower, a bit like a sunflower. It's been created to hold up whatever it's holding up. And is that not a miracle? That each stem holds up a different flower. And that's all possible, that's all there for us to look and see. And perhaps when you go out of the building today there, I noticed there was some lilies, I believe, outside. Just go and look closer. Notice the little dangly petals that are part of its reproduction system. If it has an aroma, notice that aroma. Notice that some flowers don't have an aroma. But their beauty is like no other. And just look at the color. Look at the texture. Have you ever looked at a texture of the petal of a flower? So just enjoy that. It's all there for us to enjoy. It's all a miracle. And it's all available. And on days maybe when you're a little down, you might want to go on an awe walk, like the people in that study. Go on an awe walk and find a thing that you find full of wonder or awe, or even the smallest thing. Or look in a baby's eyes, a child, young child's eyes. Look at people laughing. There's just so much joy, awe, wonder in the world. Indeed, it's all a miracle. So with that, take a couple of deep breaths again. And with that in mind, slowly, slowly, slowly come back to the room and open your eyes.
Thank you so much, Alan. I'm sure you've inspired more than a few people to be out looking for awe today. Here at Unity Spiritual Center, we are an ocean of love. Here at Unity Spiritual Center, we have an inspiring vision, an exciting mission, and compelling values by which we strive to live. Please join me in saying them aloud. Our vision is, centered in God, we co-create a world powerfully transformed through the growing movement of shared spiritual awakening. Our mission is, we are a creative, joy-filled, spiritual community dedicated to healing, inspiring, and transforming the lives of all people through prayer, education, and love. And our values are, we are spirit-led, generous with resources, inclusive, joyously creative, and guided by integrity. And in this space, feeling inspired by our vision, mission, and values, and feeling so enriched by what we've experienced here today, let us take time now to be a channel for enrichment through our generous tithes and love offerings. As Michael shares the next beautiful song, please take that time to write out a check to USC, or if you're on Zoom, to make a donation online at sfunity.org/contribute. If you are here in the sanctuary, as you can see, our ushers are here prepared to take your offering. Practicing the principle of tithing ourselves as a spiritual community, we are pleased to tithe 10% of the offering collected every Sunday to various Unity organizations and local nonprofits serving our city. So let us take a moment right now to bless our tithes and love offerings as we cup them in our hands or are next to our hearts. And I wish we had an awe-inspiring picture to make sure that everybody was generous. But please join me in the offering blessing. One more, Karsten. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God.
Miracle come true. It can happen next to you. It may not be something you recognize. A miracle could be so small that you can't see. It's blossoming and spreading blooms of joy. Listen closely. Hear that sound. It whispers in your ear. It could be very near. Take a moment, look around, for it's in this very space. Now a smile upon your face, 'cause a miracle, they say, can happen every day. For all you know, it's tugging on your sleeve. A miracle can hide in the rushing of the tide. The dream you have comes flowing to the shore. Floating there, let it guide you in, and don't you be scared. Take a moment, look around, for it's in this very space. a smile upon your face, 'cause every day is a miracle. Every day is a miracle, an awe-inspiring day. An awe-inspiring day. Of every day is a miracle. Every day is a miracle.
Please join me in blessing our tithes and offerings. Spirit of the living God, bless the acts of our hands, our minds, our hearts. May everything offered here at Unity Spiritual Center be a reflection of all that is good within us. Grant us the courage to patiently listen for the stirring of your presence. Enliven our spirits with humor. Fill us with reverence for one another and gratitude for our diversity. May unity, beauty, and truth be the fruit of all we do. And so it is. Amen. We turn now to gratitudes and announcements. And for gratitudes, of course, our great gratitude goes to Allen Klein for coming and speaking with us today and bringing a message. And as always, to Michael and Ron for bringing music. We are grateful to Kathy for being our greeter this morning, and to Valerie and Shirley for being our ushers, and to Karsten for running the slides again. Thank you all. As far as announcements go, the meditations, the daily word readings and guided meditations are happening on Mondays and Thursdays at noon. Always volunteer opportunities. I'm sure Karsten would love somebody to do the slideshows once in a while besides him. And we need people to come up and be the platform assistant. And also next month, there will be a new member class. So if you know somebody who wants to put their membership with us, have them speak to me or pick up a brochure that's on the back table, and that'll explain everything. And that's coming up on August 24th. So I know that Ruben and Josephine are both online, so maybe our children are here too. So let us bless our children. We love you, we bless you, we appreciate you, and we behold the presence of God in you, empowering you to do great things.
Thank you.
And so we go forth, looking for awe, looking for the miracle of everyday life. So go forth from this place in the coming day, in the coming week, knowing that the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. Wherever I am, God is. And all is well. Thank you, God.
Get that done.